Well, hey everyone, that's a kind of good that you have a light in the face. You don't see actually auditory, but okay, I will try to avoid that light. As it stated, I'm IT security architect, and today we're going to try to show something more about Asia. I hope that coffee break was good. You have enough coffee, not just went to sleep. And and I was kind of surprised to see that in other talks, Azure itself was not mentioned. And so I'm wondering how many of you have experience of working with Azure. That's a good. How many of you have the production systems already deployed in Azure? Bit less, but okay. I hope that some things what I will gonna show to you will be useful and something new. Yeah, so when we are speaking about the security in all times, the security was always responsibility of someone else, like, you know, security department team, and usually we as developers, we were so far away from them, and we didn't care. We just went to the production, deployed our code, and maybe sometimes the security person showed up and said, like, hey, no, you will not gonna go to the production, because we need to make a security review, so deadline will gonna be postponed for the 2 weeks, and you are like, come on, security guys, you don't bring a value for us, you just break our stuff. It is going to change, and not just because we are tired of the security or something, but it just because we are introducing the DevOps, we are introducing cloud, and everything is changed. If previously you didn't had any access to the infrastructure side, then now you are like taking over even the infrastructure side. So these changes affect not only the security, these changes affect also infrastructure teams, and because developers are taking more and more as responsibilities. And yeah, so basically developers are in the driver's seat now, and security accountability is transferred also to the developers, which is good and which is challenging. I'm working daily with the developers, and at the beginning I got kind of the frustrations from them, like, hey, now I need to think about the security, now I need to learn the networking. Isn't too much for me? I mean, like, I just want to write my code, deploy it, and forget about all other things. But is it possible? Is not possible? Actually, it is possible. And just because the cloud gives not only the access to the unlimited resources, but it also gives the tools, the support for handling networking, infrastructure side, the security things in a good way. Like, for example, if you look on the Amazon, Netflix have produced a really nice tool, the House Monkey. Like, I don't know how many of you have you tried that, used? Yeah, that's a good tool, and honestly, I should say that I'm missing that in Azure, but I hope something similar will gonna show up. Yeah, as I'm mentioning, the cloud gives a lot of the tools. We just need to learn them. Let's look on some Azure security services. And what I can promise that this is the only one slide which is overdosed with the text. Because actually I don't like to have, like, you know, a lot of the text, and it's not possible to read and becomes boring. But the point why I'm showing this slide actually is just to show how many of the support things Azure is providing you in each area, when it comes to the security general, when it comes to the storage security, when it comes to identity and access management. So everything what you need is partly or fully covered by the cloud services, and you just don't need to think about how it is implemented, you just need to use them. And since I'm kind of limited in the time, I will just will take some of the tools and we're gonna look on them. Usually when I'm doing the training for the developers and kind of the onboarding sessions about the cloud, I prefer to start with the Azure Security General, and by this I mean the Security Center. This is a really good service provided by the Microsoft, which if you are enabling immediately when you have signed up in the Azure and got your subscription, with default policies, it allows to you to see what is the health status for your resources deployed in the Azure. So basically, it touches different areas. Like we can see, this is a screenshot from the production. Me as a security, I'm not kind of satisfied with these red lines. And I think I need to have a talk with some of the developers about this later. But as you can see, you can see the security health in different areas like the compute, the networking, the storage, and even for the applications. And even more, if you are going more in the details, you can see what exactly is wrong with your solutions. What is wrong, for example, in with your virtual machines located in Azure? So basically, you can see that endpoint protection is not deployed, and missing system updates and so on. But what is the biggest beauty of that security center? That it's not only provides the status and the recommendations how to fix them, but also provides like the one-click possibility to fix this recommendation. Or the finding, should I say. Let's look on the in reality, how it looks like, and I just need to win a fight with the screens. Good. Basically, this is a dashboard which is customized by me. This is my test subscription, so no real data. If we will go... Now I need to find, it's a bit challenging. So if you will go and choose the security center, we can see immediately the status for the mine own resources here. And like I have a SQL database deployed, and I can immediately see that the encryption is not enabled, the threat detection is not enabled. So yeah, that's kind of the bad. Because encryption we need not only for the compliance purposes, but we would like to have be safe and know that our data is not visible by anyone else who is like working on the Azure side. The threat analysis allows, actually it's a quite good service which allows to detect anomalies in the behaviors if someone is downloading too much data from your database, or the user is working with the non-regular comments or something related to the database. And as we can see, it's kind of easy to enable it. It takes just one click, and cool, it's deployed, everything works, and fantastic. We have fixed one security issue. Security team is happy now. So speaking about the recommendations, we can see all the recommendation lists like I showed, yeah. And we can also look on the policies. So basically, when you're enabling the security center, immediately it defines some default policies for your subscription, which is my subscription here. And you can to look on the prevention policies, which allows you to provide all of these recommendations what you have seen, and as you can see, there are pretty much. And when you start to play around with all of these services, I suggest you to enable all of them. And of course, some of them maybe is not applicable for your environment. For example, with next generation firewall, maybe you are using the network security groups, which we're going to look later, or some other things. And of course, Azure will not going to detect on your application these next generation firewalls, and it will going to start to scream and produce the false positive for you. So, yeah, but at the beginning, it's quite a good thing where to start. And this is one of the things what I'm suggesting for our architects, developers, that you need to follow on the security center just to feel safe, that you are compliant with some of the at least general security environments. Yeah, and let's look on the application architecture. So basically, of course, we are ready, we have the access to the Azure, and we want to deploy something. And immediately what comes into my mind is like, hey, how about the infrastructure things? How should they be done in Azure? In the same way what you are doing on the premises. So basically, the architecture patterns, the architecture security architecture pattern stays the same. Like you have the front-end subnet, back-end subnet. On the front-end subnet, you are deploying all your resources, which will be like widely exposed and available for everyone from the internet. So basically, the DMZ thing. And usually, from the practical perspective, in Azure, there is virtual networks. And in each VNet, you can deploy as many as you want the subnets. But what you should remember that the routing between the subnets is enabled by default, so all the resources between the both of subnets are available, which is not kind of the good from the security perspective if you are making the DMZ network. And one of the patterns what I'm suggesting for the teams is always like to make the DMZ fully like as a virtual network, fully separate VNet, because between the VNets there's no kind of like access, and so resources deployed in DMZ VNet subnet are not visible to the internal VNet subnet. By this I mean like with the internal IPs. I'm not speaking about the public IPs. So basically, all the front-end things you are deploying in DMZ VNet, that's good. And what you can deploy actually in the VNet is mostly the IaaS type of the resources. So I'm speaking about the virtual machines. And you can apply the network security groups also. We will look on them later, but I will get back on this. But speaking about the deployment, then these are mostly like the virtual machines. But as you can see from my architecture, I have mentioned the web API, Azure functions, and the logic apps. These PaaS services can be integrated. So what it means, if you take the web app, in the configuration, there is availability to make the VNet integration. And this is needed if you're where is my mouse? No, again. Yeah, I found it. Yeah, so why you need to integrate the web app in the VNet? Because you would like to have an access to the internal resources which are located in another DMZ and available only by the internal IPs. So basically, by default, web app is like the PaaS solution, and all the access routing happens through the internet. And of course, it will not going to find out the internal IP. And that's why you are making the VNet integration towards the internal VNet. And yeah, then web app can have an access to all internal resources located in the internal VNet. But like I mentioned it before, to be able to make the communication between the DMZ VNet towards internal VNet, you need to set up the VNet peering, just like with a few clicks, and done quite easily. And of course, you have the DMZ VNet, you have the internal VNet, you need to protect them. And the first what comes into my mind is network security groups. which is kind of the firewall, really simple firewall. You can think about the comparison with the face control standing in the entrance of the bar. The guy is not checking your stuff, what you have in the pockets, maybe sometimes, but mostly we're looking on your identity. So NSG is kind of that. That guy is only checking the incoming, outgoing ports, which are allowed, not allowed. No, also, I mean the IP addresses, but doesn't make any traffic inspection. So you can think also about them as an access control list. Yeah, and the good practice is, of course, to apply NSG on DMZ VNet with the rules denied all inbound, denied all outbound, and allow only the specific IPs from the specific source to destination towards the internal VNet and, of course, from the external world. So, as you can see, the rules are pretty the same as we have on the premises, but maybe the difference is that someone else was taking care about this before, like infrastructure team or the security team. And this is now where you need to think if you are working in the DevOps world. Yeah, and of course, in the ideal scenario, you just moved all your applications to cloud and you're happy. But we know that this is not something what happens in the company because we have on-premises things like all our legacy systems and so on. And the most popular scenarios with which I'm dealing daily are the hybrid scenarios. So basically, we have also on-premises resources. And we are connected towards Azure via Express Road. For the big companies, which is a good choice, because you have a lot of the traffic towards Azure and so on. But for the smaller companies or for the private projects, if you want to connect back to your another data center, you can set up easily the VPN. The logic stays the same, except that Express Road is a kind of the bus line. This is like the specifically the dedicated line for you with the warranty of the agreed speed, but it doesn't provide any protection. Like in the bus line, even we have the rules that you are not allowed to drive on the bus line, but come on, you can just do it and you can see who's driving on that bus line. So if you are establishing the express road, still you need to think about the encryption on the transport layer. Yeah, and so basically when the connection is established, you are just extending your network to Azure. And usually when this connection is established, it can be site-to-site if you are speaking about the VPN point-to-site, so from this one specific resource to your internal network. And if you are speaking about the kind of the site-to-site, when, as you can see, I have a dot marked from the internal VNet towards the internal on-premises network. Yeah, so it means that the services which are located in internal VNet, they can't reach the resources located in the DMZ VNet. This is another limitation of the VNet peering. But at the same time, I think this is a good thing. We just don't want to have DMZ accessible for from DMZ resources accessible our internal resources which are located on the premises. Yeah, some best practices, what we need to remember when we are making infrastructure part on Azure are pretty the same what we have today on premises. So basically, logically segment subnets or even make the separate VNets. Use virtual network appliances. By this I mean, yes, we have network security groups, but this is not enough if you want to have more advanced functionalities like the traffic inspection and such things. And a lot of virtual appliances are provided on the marketplace in Azure. So it's again like next, installed and finished. And then it's more trickier to configure them. Yeah, and of course, one of the things, I'm not deeply touching the virtual machines in this session, because we are speaking about the web applications, but what should you remember when you are deploying the virtual machine, RDP ports are available, and if you're deploying the virtual machine with the public interface, from practice, I can say it takes less than 2 minutes that your RDP port starts to be brute forced. Just because there are script kiddies who are scanning the Azure network segments all the time for the looking for the some weak configurations. It's worth to mention that the Azure itself provides a really good protection level, so like your DDoS and such things you don't need to think. You need to think about the web application security. Yeah, and when it comes to the web applications, the new perimeter in the security is nowadays is access control. So basically, you are protecting your application with the access control. It's not anymore like, hey, I will gonna put it somewhere in the internal network, or we'll put the firewalls and so on. These things are not working anymore. The business wants to have their solutions publicly available. And of course, the first thing what you think is like, hey, how are we going to protect this in a really good way? So, yeah, and if we are speaking about the access control, then I would like to mention today is how we should manage access to Azure resources, how to implement authentication and authorization for the web applications, and how secure to secure connections between application and the services. And of course, what is Azure Key Vault? Yeah, when it comes to the Azure itself, it provides the role-based control in Azure. So basically, when you have created the subscription, you have a different roles on the subscription level, and it means that everyone who are assigned with that role on the subscription level by default has an access to all resource groups and all the resources in that subscription, so you should be kind of the careful. And the default role is like the owner, you can do everything. And another one who can do everything except adding and managing the users is a contributor. And then also the Azure provides a lot of the customized roles for the specific tasks, like deploying the machine, creating only the resource group, like name it. Yeah, and it's kind of easy to manage them. And also you can see what is fantastic in Azure, we are providing the log capabilities. So everything what you are doing in Azure is logged. Everything. And by default stored for the 90 days. So basically you can see who have granted access to another resource and who have done what. Yeah, I'm just looking on the time. Yeah, but of course, we as developers, we think about our application, like, hey, how should I implement the authentication and authorization part? And for that, you can use, actually, Azure Active Directory. Despite of the name Active Directory, this is not the commercial monster what we used to see on the premises, like the Active Directory. Azure Active Directory is all about the identity, so it works only for the managing of the identities. It doesn't care about the group policies, actually they don't have them, and and this is the good thing what you can use, and it is for free up to 10 applications and for up to 500,000 of the objects. So, yeah, but if you look from the application side, how we can integrate the Azure AD configuration, there are 5 common scenarios. Unfortunately, I'm kind of limited in the time, so I will go briefly. As you can see, the most common scenarios what we have today on the development, like single-page applications, web to web API to web API, all of them are supported by the Azure AD. What is most important to remember that Azure AD is using OAuth, OpenID, and the SAML. It can't speak with the, all these commercial protocols like Kerberos, which is mostly what you're using on the premises. But that's fine. I mean, like, the modern web authentication is OAuth and OpenID, which is a reality. So let's look on the simple application. I have deployed really simple application, and it took me to integrate the authentication process like around 10 minutes, not more. So we have the login page. I need to log out to show the effect. So AAD takes all the things for the authentication process, and you don't need to take care about this. You're just receiving the tokens. And what it does, at the moment that you are trying to log in, it goes to your Azure AD tenant, and this is mine, which is customized. As you can see, you can take the logo of your company and fully customize it. And it's typing. So as you can see, the login process, the authentication process is really simple. And what is in the background of that? In the background, this application is single page application. So what I did at the beginning, I just registered. It's kind of tricky. I just registered my application in the Azure. Not here. This is what happens when you're... Okay, let's close this. So I have registered my application. Provided some basic configuration here for the user groups. I just need to go slightly different. Come on. So it's kind of tricky when you don't see, like, so you're registering your application with a few clicks. You're adding like the reply URL, so Azure AD knows where to send the tokens back when your user is authenticated. And one trick with the single page application is you just need slightly to modify the manifest to add the implicit of implicit flow, which is by default is not enabled. And by default, Azure returns the token, which contains really basic information about the user. And if you need to know also his groups, for example, in Azure AD, you just need to enable this specifically in the by adding the security groups. And then the token is returned with the, all the groups what the user has up to 200. And if you look on the code, then the code itself is really simple one. On the Angular side, where is added only like my tenant, so which is a subscription name, and the client ID, so the application ID. And for the .NET side, I have just added like this pretty the same information. Why it makes so easy? Just because you have included the library, other library. In this case, it's Angular Adel, JavaScript library provided by the Microsoft, and with a few clicks, you have it. And this is one of the bad practices. Never include the links to, as references to your used libraries. I think a lot of you maybe have heard the case where the guy have decided just to remove one of the packages, and a lot of the companies have suffered from them because they are just made the remote linking. So this is not the security good practice, and I'm showing this with the proposal. Okay, yeah. So, but of course, as I mentioned, one of the biggest things is we have applications on the premises. And of course, you have developed applications on the premises a long time ago, and you don't want to think about re-implementing OAuth to support, to be able to support the Azure AD or even to publish your internal application widely. So for that, you have the Azure Application Proxy, which does really good things. First of all, if you have, like I mentioned, on-premises application, and you don't want to expose it, like to set up it in DMZ and so on, you're just configuring the only one connector or two for the load balancing on your premises, like as you can see on the slide. And then you are just connecting your application, pointing in the connector with the SPN names, Azure Application Proxy gets the configuration also. You're providing the external address. Then your application becomes available and protected by the identity, by the authentication. And authentication is done by the Azure AD part. That's simply. And this is one of the things what we are using also for the publishing or making the connection back on the small applications which you want to integrate. For example, you have developed a new web app, fully worked with the AAD authentication, which is fantastic, but you would like to include in the e-frames some of the on-premises application part, or you just want to provide the identity of the user back on the premises solution, like API or another web application which is located on the premises and which can speak only on the Kerberos. That's not a problem. You are just integrating this in the Azure Application Proxy. When someone logs in your web app located in Azure AD, that token is transferred to the application proxy and it does some kind of the basic mapping, and your on-premises application gets already the Kerberos ticket. But it works in one way, no from the Kerberos to OAuth. So yeah, that's a good thing if you are not able to refactor your application on the premises to support OAuth. From the practice, what I should admit, you should be ready maybe for the in this particular scenario, with the speed things. Microsoft have been acknowledged about this and they are working on that, so it can give you additional milliseconds for the authentication. But otherwise, it's quite a good solution. So, speaking about the securing connections between the application and the services, I would like to remind some of the good practices, like keep password and connection strings out of the source. Seriously, keep them out. Don't put private stuff in the common configuration files, especially if you're using the GitHub and the publicly available source code repositories. You can mistakenly upload your configuration files also to the GitHub, and time to time the security guys are doing some research and checking how many other projects actually have the sensitive case located in the GitHub, and it happens pretty much. And of course, use environment variables or user level config options in case if you're not able to put these sensitive keys somewhere else, for example in the deployment servers. And when you are deploying the web services towards Azure, then use application settings. So like I said, keep password and connection strings out. It's this is the rule, what the first thing what we discuss always with the developers. And these are like kind of the examples on the .NET. So as you can see in the in version 4.6, you can just make this separate configuration file and moving it out from your repository, so to say. .NET 5 introduced a new concept of the user secrets and user levels secrets, where the key value part does exist in the file, but that file is not in your project folder, but it's stored on OS user profile folder. Yeah, and as I said, but of course, if you have the full deployment pipeline, then the good practice is to use the deployment servers like the TeamCT Octopus and take care with these variables there. Of course, there is another question, like who have an access to the deployment servers. We always can see these variables, but again, it's even better than just to leave all these sensitive things in the code. And like I mentioned, it, but if you are speaking about the Azure part, when you are making the web app, you can just to configure your secure strings in application settings, and only you who have access to that resource will be able to see these keys. So basically, if you look on the same application, where is my mouse again? It's again. Yeah. So if you are going to the application settings, then it provides the possibility to put all the application settings, configurations, and the connection strings. I think I have scrolled. Yeah, but I think I have here some of them, yeah. Just to show as example. Yeah, as you can see, of course, you can see these passwords, but they are protected and taken care of by the Azure, and this is why it's important to have appropriate role-based access control on your resources in the Azure, so to be sure that no one else can, who is not supposed to see, is not seeing these passwords. But yeah, so basically, you are putting this in application setting configuration, and you don't need to store them in the code. And all the thing what you are doing is adding in webconfig the key for your application settings, so to be able to retrieve these values. And of course, another thing is when you are dealing with the certificates, when you are dealing with the keys or the password things which are shared between different projects, in your code, the best place what to use is the Azure Key Vault, which is like the wallet where you can define the access, who have an access, what kind of the applications have an access, and what type of the access, like reading only, managing them, and so on. And when it comes to the code, then it's quite easy. You just take again the Nugget package from the Microsoft, slightly modify the webconfig, and grabbing the token, access token in the code. So, yeah, of course, this raises up the again the question like, hey, we just discussed that don't put the secrets in the web.config. And we can see like, hey, we have the secret URL towards the Azure Key Vault. Yeah, that's the tricky part. Then, you can save it again either in the deployment environment or the machine environment. Yeah, this is about the access control. And briefly speaking about the data protection, yeah, I said that I have one slide, but actually I have two slides with over those texts. When it comes to the data protection, all of these things are taken care by the Azure. So when it comes to data in transit, all the connections between the resources are encrypted. All the connections towards the database and so on. All of them are by default encrypted. Microsoft have done a lot of work to put everything on encryption level. Redundancy and at rest data protection is also implemented, and as you saw, it's just one click on off for the databases and for the data storages. Yeah, but actually, only thing what you need to think is the encryption, and the encryption stuff again. From the infrastructure part, it's also covered. You can encrypt your virtual machines easily. Not so easy as with the SQL. It requires some additional steps. But the idea is that when you're enabling that encryption, the keys are stored in the key vault. And if there's a need, they're just can be also automatically rotated. SQL Server provides transparent data encryption by default. It also provides even more the cell level encryption, so you can encrypt specific rows on the database. Azure storages, not all of them are supporting the encryption yet, but most used, what I have seen from our projects, like the blobs, the Documentum, they are supporting the encryption. And yeah, other things. So basically, like I mentioned to you, this is really it's kind of easy to do. And actually, I saved one database for you just to show how we can encrypt it. So again, as I said, that you don't need to take care about how good encryption level is. It's taken by the Azure. So you as a developer, you just once have clicked and forgot about this, and you are compliant with the requirements. Yeah, as you can see from the infrastructure part, you have a really good supporter tools covered by the Azure, and Microsoft is bringing more and more of these tools. But of course, what you need to take care of is application security. And yeah. No matter where you're deploying your application, is it the cloud-native application or the on-premises, problems remain the same. So again, we are speaking about the injections, we are speaking about the code quality itself, and I think this is why we are here in this conference, and we had really good talks yesterday and also today they are going, which are mostly focused on the how to protect your application. So. Implementing the WAF, the mod security, for example. Yesterday there was a really good talk about the new functionalities in the mod security. And also on conference you can just grab and you should see with how to secure the HTTP headers and like these things. And specifically speaking about the mod security, you can make it also as a part in a web application. As a PaaS solution, but the better scenario, what I always suggest, is to use a web application gateway, which is a service provided by the Microsoft, which takes care not only about the load balancing, but also about the traffic inspection. And what is interesting, that the Microsoft actually is using the mod security behind that. So the mod security is integrated in the web application firewall. Remember about the deployment pipeline, which could be fully another topic. Partly it was covered on yesterday's talk about the software-defined infrastructure. I was top 10. And another thing is continuously scanning the web applications. And in that sense, when you will deploy the web app, you will gonna see in the properties that you are able to enable service, which will gonna make with the penetration test or the web scanning automatically on your chosen time. I mean, like once per month, twice per week, or yeah. So basically, even such tools are available there. Yeah, and what is the most fantastic of all of about this is that as you can see, everything is a code. So infrastructure is a code. So You're working with the infrastructure as with the, another type of the program. And last thing I would like to show is like, this is like the code example, how you're deploying the infrastructure, which I briefly discussed today. So how you're deploying the VNets, how you're deploying the firewall, like the network security groups, and how you're deploying the, even the virtual machines. You're just defining them in on the code level. But still, you need to remember about application security. Don't forget about this. In the cloud environment, the only thing where you need really to focus is on your application security level. Yeah. That's all from my side. I tried to run through all of these things. And as I said, that 45 minutes is not enough to go into details. But I hope I have managed to give you a good overview of the Azure security best practices.